matchless name of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
For it's at the name of Jesus that every knee will bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth. And every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's a blessing to be in the house of the Lord one more time. We're going to jump right into the word of the Lord. Our theme this year is much word, much fruit. Amen. We believe that if you get enough word in you, you'll produce some kind of fruit in your life. Amen. And so we've been for the past month and a half, going on 2 months, we have ministered from a sermon series on salvation and redemption, and we want to continue in that same vein today. We give God praise for our first time visitor. We pray that something will be said or done that will make you want to come back and worship with us. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to read from two different passages of scripture today, the first being in Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15, beginning with verse 21. When you have it, you can say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Matthew chapter 15, beginning with verse 21. The Bible reads on this wise from the King James Version. It says, "Then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with a devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, It is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, Truth, Lord. Yet the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour." Go to Mark chapter 7. Mark chapter 7, beginning with verse 24. Mark chapter 7, beginning with verse 24. When you have it, say, praise the Lord. The Bible says, "And from thence he arose, and went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and entered into a house, and would have no man know it. But he could not be hid. For a certain woman, whose young daughter had an unclean spirit, heard of him, and came and fell at his feet." The woman was a Greek. Now we know who she is. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation. And she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. But Jesus said unto her, "Let the children first be filled, for it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it unto the dogs." And she answered and said unto him, "Yes, Lord, that's right. You're saying the right thing. But yet the dogs under the table, they eat of the children's crumbs." And he said unto her, "For this saying, go thy way, the devil is gone out of thy daughter." And when she was come to her house, she had to see if it was real. She had to see if it was true. And when she was come to her house, she found the devil gone out and her daughter laid upon the bed. Can we say amen? Are you still standing? Let's pray. Gracious and eternal God, we thank you for another opportunity to break the bread of life. Oh God, speak in the midst of your people. Oh God, send us a word. Somebody said, if we don't hear from you, we don't know what we do. But great God, speak in the midst of your people. Oh God, it's not by power, nor is it by might, but it's by your spirit. We call on the Holy Ghost today. Have your way, great God, that you are. And all the saints of the living God said, amen. You may take your seats in the presence of the Lord.
Amen. Bless the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Find you a neighbor. A good neighbor now. Don't find somebody that's just here. Find somebody that came for a word from the Lord. And touch that neighbor and say, neighbor.
Oh neighbor,
just give me the crumbs. That was the wrong person. Find somebody else and touch them like you mean it and say, neighbor. Oh neighbor, just give me the crumbs. Somebody give the Lord a praise right there. Just give me the crumbs. I don't need the big stuff, but just give me the crumbs. I'll take the leftovers. I'll take what everybody else throws away, what everybody else doesn't want. Just give me the crumbs. We live in a rather compromising world. Because of this world's trends, many people compromise their integrity. They compromise their morals, and they compromise their salvation and their walk with the Lord. Because today is Youth Sunday, I must speak in a tone that is relative or something that they can relate to. Glory to God. Some of the teenagers and preteens in this world, they were raised in the church. They had parents who led them in the admonition of Christ. And they have happened to be trained in their local ministries to fear and serve the Lord. However, they too, in many instances, have turned from the faith. And they have began to compromise that which they know is right and that which they know is a pillar for their families for generations. They have begun to compromise the very election and calling that God has placed upon their life. Many people, glory to God, have compromised to the degree, hallelujah, many people that have been anointed to sing and anointed to preach and anointed to lay hands on the sick, glory to God, these people are now selling drugs and dating the same gender and using drugs and clubbing all times of the night and addicted to alcohol and having illicit sex, and the list goes on and on and on. And as a young person who is saved, as someone who's sanctified, and I believe that I've been filled with the Holy Ghost and I've been saved for quite some time, I have learned that there has been a great compromise in the church community, especially amongst our young people. Can we say amen? Much of this compromise has taken place because the methods and doctrines of the church have been compromised and changed by men. Even the gospel music that was once designed to touch the heart and call men and women out of their worldly deeds, it has now been compromised to where now gospel music, it does not appeal to those of us who have been saved by grace, but now gospel music. It appeals to the worldly spectrum. It appeals to those people, glory to God, that are still dropping it like it's hot. It no longer appeals to those of us who have been called into this illustrious grace. And I must tell you that these new trends, glory to God, they are not the direct derivative of something that has been sent by the devil. We cannot continue to blame the devil for the things that we have control over. Some of the issues that we are dealing with in our communities and ministries are the result of people who have compromised the gospel and compromised their Holy Ghost conviction. And one of the things that the church must understand is that when you are on this journey of salvation, you cannot take alternative route of compromise, because you will soon find out that the end result will always be confusion and spiritual desolation. There should never be a time where the sinner man comes to church and he feels comfortable just like he was at the club. There should never be a time, wish I had a church here. There should never be a time where the sinner man comes in the house of God and he does not feel convicted for the way he is living. If he comes, glory to God, to the house of God and we have compromised so much, and he can sit back and cross his arm like nilly willy, like nothing has happened, something has gone wrong with the church of the living God. The sinner man ought to be able to come in the house of God and feel the Holy Ghost so strong that he comes tumbling down to the altar and saying, what must I do to be? I wish I had a church to help me preach this morning. You gotta understand, my dear brothers and my dear sisters, that when Paul and Silas were locked behind jail bars, the Bible said that they began to sing and praise the Lord. Glory to God. And when the earthquake came and the shackles were loose off their feet, the prison guard, hallelujah, awakening out of his sleep, the Bible said that he came and he drew out his sword. He was going to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul said, do yourself no harm. We are all right here. And what does the Bible say? The Bible said, glory to God, that he came and he was shaking in his boots, but he just had one question. What must I do to be saved? And it was not because an earthquake came. It was not because they were just singing. But I believe that the power of the Holy Ghost fell in that prison, and he said, what I'm doing is wrong, and I've got to do something to get back in alignment with God. And that's what the church needs to do. We come to church now and we got a mind on this thing and a mind on that thing, and what we gonna eat after church, and what we gonna wear to work tomorrow, and what's going on at Walmart and the next sale that's at Belkin. We don't come, glory to God, touching and agreeing on one accord. But you must understand, when you get on one accord with God and you do not compromise the Holy Ghost and compromise what God is trying to do, you will be surprised of the spiritual, supernatural things that can happen in the house of God. But we gotta come to church and begin to touch, and wherever two or three are gathered in his name, he said, I will. The sinner man comes to church and doesn't know if he's in church anymore. He comes to church and doesn't know if he's under the presence of God. I just need about 10 people that can say the compromise is over. There is a standard for living right. There is a standard for the church of the living God. Hallelujah. And you must understand, the Bible said there is a way that seemeth right, but the end is always death. You can't take, glory to God, the back door and get in by the window and jump over the fence and jump over the gate. Jesus said, I am.
say amen. You must understand today, the Bible says, Jesus says, verily, verily, I say unto you, that he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up by some other way, he is a thief and he is a robber. But he says, I am the door, and if you come by me, you shall go in and out and find pasture. You cannot get to God no other way but by Jesus the Christ. Jesus said, I am the way. I feel like preaching now, y'all. I am the truth and I am the light. No man is going to come to the Father save he come by me. For some odd reason, the church has begun to accept standards that are lower than desirable. Many saints have taken on the traits of the world, and in return, they have compromised the gospel of Jesus Christ. But Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power given unto men whereby they must be saved. Come on, somebody. Now, you must understand this. Catch this. Let me preface our conversation. I am in no way speaking specifically to the sin that is running rampant in the religious community, because that is an issue that must be dealt with in itself. Today, I want to shed some light on the darkness that is clouding the eyes of the saints. I am referring to the practices of the church that are in actuality are worldly. Come on, y'all. Some of the practices of the church have placed the kingdom of God in the same category as juke joints, hole in the walls, bars, and nightclubs. And this should not be so. We should not have to compromise the identity of the church to win anybody over. The church should be the church no matter what. We shouldn't change ourselves to get them. They need to change themselves to become a part of the church of the living God. I wish I had a church to help me preach this morning. The identity of the church, glory to God, was not given by us. We did not create the church, so we don't have the authority to change the church. There were two institutions that God left perfected when Jesus left here. That was marriage and the church. And ever since Jesus went back to the Father, men of this world have tried to change marriage and the church. They tried to allow, glory to God, the same sex to marry each other. They tried to allow. I know there's not going to be a lot of people that want to help me this morning, but you got to understand, if we're going to be the church, we cannot have church rap in the church. Why? Because it sounds too much like the world. They're using the same beats of the world. They're using the same music of the world. And when we, those of us that have come out of sin, when we, glory to God, come in the house and we hear those songs, we don't hear the new lyrics, but we hear what we used to hear when we were in the world. When you come to the house of God, you need to get some new salt. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Pass me not. Oh, hold on to God's unchanging hand. The identity of the church is not a secular identity. It's a pure and it's a wholesome identity. Come on, somebody say amen. The Bible says this is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness. You must understand the glory of God. The Bible says that if we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we are a liar. Come on, somebody say amen. Glory to God. But if we walk with him in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus, it cleanses us from all of our sin. You must understand, I told the saints on yesterday, there is no gray area in God. Either you're going to be black or you're going to be white. Either you're going to be hot or you're going to be cold.
John the Revelator said lukewarm, he will spew you out of his mind. I want you to understand that we have to begin to destroy the spirit of compromise in the church. Because catch this, this theology of compromise, it teaches believers to become like or similar mannerisms like that of the world. And in return, the world will identify with you. And this is the biggest lie that the devil has sold to the church. Come on, somebody say amen. When you use the world's way and the world's channel, you do not challenge people to come out of their sin. What you do to them is just go to church and you're going to be all right. Just come to church and everything's going to be good. But it don't work like that. I wish that everybody that came to church would be able to go back with the Lord, but it ain't going to be like that. Except you come out of your wicked way, except you put sin down, that's the only way that, although y'all don't believe me, he said be at peace with all men and holiness without, no man shall see the Lord. It's either going to be holiness or hell. And I know we don't preach that kind of stuff anymore, but hell is real. And the Bible said that in hell, even the worm would not burn. And I want you to understand today, glory to God, that when you get down there, there is no repentance after the grave. If you don't do it on this side, you're going to wake up in
I was listening to a message by Bishop Ayanna Locke, and one of the things that she was sharing with the people was, she said the devil has sent something in the church. He sent the world's way in the church, and some of us don't have enough discernment to know what's the world and what's God.
And so what happens is, glory to God, we accept that way and we take on that way, and we wonder why people are not getting saved and why people are not getting delivered. It's because the devil has blinded you and he got you believing, glory to God, that is the right way. But Paul said, Lord, open the eyes of our understanding that we might be able to see like you see, talk like you talk, walk like I feel like preaching this morning, y'all. You got to understand, the Bible said we got to come out from among them and be ye separated. We got to separate ourselves from the ways of the world, because we are a chosen generation. We are a royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. We are a peculiar people. We're not supposed to look like the world. And I know I ain't going to get many amens on this, but we don't even supposed to dress like the world.
Preacher,
yes, I think I will. Just for a few, you gotta understand that we can't dress like the world. We can't talk like the world. We can't hang like the world. Either you gonna be a part of the body of Christ and be a witness with your life, or you might as well go somewhere and sit down. People ought to be able to look at you and say, I don't know what it is about them, but there's just something different about them. You don't got to go around with a cross around your neck and a t-shirt that says, I'm saved since October 99. You don't got to have a stamp on your forehead that says, I'm a believer. But when you walk in the room, you ought to be saddled with so much light. You ought to be saddled with so much God that when you walk in the room, they say, I don't know what's wrong with brother man, but there's something about him that's different. And the thing that he had, just give me the cross. I want everything. Whatever he had, I need it. Whatever he got, I need it. And don't you want to know what I got? It's called the Holy Ghost. And when the Holy Ghost gets down in the city of your soul, he'll make a change in your life. Touch somebody, say, just give me the cross.
Yeah. Let's work the text and get out of here. The Bible said that there was a certain woman down in Tyre and Sidon. And this woman comes to Jesus. And she says, Jesus, I got a son.
I got a daughter, and this particular daughter, she has a devil. See, you got to understand that there are some things going on in our young people. It's not a mental illness. It's not a sickness that the doctors can prescribe medicine for. Some of the things that are challenging our young people is a spirit. It's a devil. Y'all not talking. And so you got to have enough Holy Ghost to discern what is medical and what is spiritual. You must understand, because we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but there's some devils out here that's trying to attach themselves to the body of Christ. And so she comes to Jesus and she says, Jesus, I need a little help. I need you to deliver my daughter from this devil. And so the Bible says, hallelujah, the Bible says, glory to God, that she was a Greek Phoenician woman. First off, Greeks were Gentiles, which meant they were sinners. She was a Syrophoenician woman. She was not even a child of Israel. And so Jesus, number one, didn't even have any business having conversation with her. He wasn't even supposed to be talking to her. And so Jesus didn't say anything. You must understand sometimes that your first thought is not always your best thought. And sometimes you got to learn to stay quiet until God starts talking. And so the Bible says, hallelujah, and I'm going to try to get out of here, but the Bible says, glory to God, that the disciples came and they said, Jesus, get this woman out of here. She's coming up here asking for all of this help. We can't help her. Get her out of here. Girl, you must understand that there's always going to be some people that don't want to see you get your breakthrough. There's always going to be some people that don't want to see you get delivered. But Jesus didn't even say anything to them. And Jesus looked at her and said, one thing you got to know, it is not meat for us to give the children's bread to the dogs. You don't belong to the house of God. You don't belong in the religious cult. This is not your spectrum. You are a sinner. And so she said, I understand that. But she threw herself at the mercy of his feet. And so when he says she was down, she was a dog. She was literally looking like a dog. Because she was down there and she was looking up at Jesus. So she was down there like a dog. But she said, you can call me a dog, but one thing I know for sure is that even the dogs get to eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Catch this. Here's the good part. The good part is this. Matthew says that even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall. But Mark said that even the dogs sit under the table and they eat the children's bread. And so in Matthew, it says they're eating the master's crumbs. But in Mark, it said they're eating the children's bread. Catch this revelation. You must understand what she was saying is, I know your children eat messy. I know that when they get to eating, they're not everything on the plate is not going to go in their mouth. And that's what happens in the house of God. So many of us are saved. We take what we want out of the message and we leave everything else as the crumbs. I just wish there were about 10 people in here. I can say, John, if you don't eat your whole plate, give me the crumbs. Give me the leftover stuff. Because you must understand something. It might look like crumbs to you, but I can be made whole. If I just get the crumbs, I can get my breakthrough. If I just get the crumbs, I can get a miracle. If I can just get the crumbs, I don't need filet mignon. You can keep your T-bone steak. Keep your barbecue. Keep all your pulled pork. Just give me the leftover stuff. It might not look like a lot, but when you add Jesus to the equation, it's more than enough. I gotta get out of here. But touch three people around you and say, just Crumbs. Give me the leftover stuff. If you don't want it, I'll take it. If you can't eat it, I'll take it. Whatever you want me to have, Lord, however you bless me, I'll be satisfied. Just give me the crumbs. Give me the leftovers. I need a blessing from the Lord. If you need a blessing, you ought to take 30 seconds and give your God some praise. Praise Him from the crumbs. Praise Him for the leftovers. What everybody else don't want. Lord, here's my cup. Fill my cup till it overflow. Give me the leftovers. I'll take it. I'll eat with you, Lord.
Yeah.
It's a shame that we come to the church and the saints of God don't have appetite for all of the world, all of the word of God. They take little bits and pieces, stuff that'll tantalize them, stuff that'll make them feel good, and they leave all the rest. But if you don't want it, I got my fork and I got my knife. I'm ready. And you must understand something. There's something called finger food. They call them hors d'oeuvres. You might have a full meal, but what you leave on the plate, I'll get a hors d'oeuvre. And I'll eat everything that you give me to crumbs.
That's all I want. That's all I want. Give me the leftover stuff. Give me the leftover stuff. Because when I had Jesus in it, Jesus took two fish. It was somebody else's little stuff. But when you had my God, He'll multiply. He'll add something to it. And when God multiplies, can't no devil in hell destroy what God multiplies. Can't no devil in hell mess up what God.
I gotta stop. I'm out of time. But Lord, just give me the crumbs. Give me the leftovers. I'll be satisfied. I don't need all the other stuff. But just give me the crumbs. This woman, catch this now. The choir is coming. Catch this. When the woman mentioned to Jesus about the crumbs, Jesus never cast out the devil. He never said anything about the devil that was in the daughter. All Jesus said is, go your way. And when she got home, she noticed that the child that was once acting crazy was now sitting straight up in the kitchen. The mother, catch this, the mother ate the crumbs, but the daughter was a beneficiary of Ephkatah. She benefited from what the mother ate. So if you get in line, there ain't no telling what'll happen in your family. There ain't no telling what'll happen on your job. If you just get in line, there ain't no telling what God will do. Will you eat the crumbs today? The crumbs that fall from the master's table? Don't compromise your walk with the Lord. If you compromise your walk with the Lord, you'll never be that person where people look and say, I want what they have. This woman noticed something about Jesus that was different from the rest of the Jews. And when Jesus said, I can't give the daughter, she could have left. She could have went and done her own thing. But she said, no. Even the dogs, I need what you have. I want what you have. I gotta have what you have. When you come in contact with people in this world, they need to be able to say whatever it is, I want it. They need to be hungry. After meeting you, they need to be hungry. They need to be hungry. Because he said, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. He said, I'll do the filling. You crave their appetite. God said, I'll do the filling. All I need you to put is aroma in their nose. I'll lay the table before them. I just need you to send their aroma. Stand to your feet. We're getting ready to go. But today, you may be like the woman. You may be that person who says, well, I'm a dog like the woman was. I'm out of the ark of safety. But Lord, if you save me, if you just clean me up, I know I'll be a better person. Today, if you don't know Jesus, will you come down to this altar? Will you give your life to the Lord? Will you let go of the spirit of compromise and say, I'm just going to do it. I don't know what it's going to be like down the road, but I'm just going to do it. Whatever it is, I'm just going to do it. You might say, well, I'm already saved, but I fell short. I stepped outside and now I'm considered a dog because I'm not doing what the children are doing. There's some crumbs at the altar for you today. Will you come and rededicate your life to the Lord? Will you come and get back in alignment with God? Will you step out on faith and say, look, preacher, I just need to get back in alignment with God. I need some strength this morning. If that's you, will you come? Will you come? Will you come? If you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, if you want to get back in line, there's some crumbs at the altar for you. There's some crumbs at the altar. Can I get some of the mothers of the church and ministers of the church to surround me? Is there somebody else that can say, it's been a long time coming. It's been a long time, but Lord, I need something new in my life. I want to eat some crumbs that fell from the master's table. If that's you, will you come? Will you come? Will you come? Will you hear his voice? Harden not your heart. Will there be another?
Just take me back to Lord.
Take me back to Lord.
To the place.
To the place.
Where I.
Anybody want to go back? Somebody said, if he has to reach way down, Jesus will pick you up. So today, the Bible says you confess to him, and he's faithful and just to forgive you. But then there's a scripture that says, if you confess to one another, we ought to pray that you might be healed. So we're going to ask now that you just take a few moments
and you confess to God, get back in alignment with God, and then we're going to pray that there be a seal over your life. We're going to pray, God, that the Holy Ghost will fall down in the city of your soul, that you begin to live with the evidence of the Holy Ghost, and you begin to walk in the ways of God, and that even when you want to go left, the Holy Ghost will pull you back and say, no, sister, I need you to stay right here. So take a few moments while she's talking to God. I need all of you to begin to pray for her life. Pray that God will cover her. Pray that God will protect her in the blood. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Begin to pray, saints. Begin to pray, saints. Begin to pray, saints. In the name of Jesus. Deliverance is happening right now in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for this soul. Father, we're not really concerned about all of the other stuff. We're not concerned about where she comes from, her background, the thing that she's facing. God, you said, whosoever will, let them come. So, Father, we pray, oh, hallelujah. We pray right now that the power of the Holy Ghost will fall and rest on this, your child. God, we pray that everything, God, that has been pulling her and drawing her away from you, we pray, God, that the Holy Ghost will block it in Jesus' name. In fact, God, we plead the blood over every satanic force that is trying to cloud her mind and harden up her heart. And in the name of Jesus, we plead the blood. Oh God, we pray right now, God, that the mind of Christ Jesus will penetrate through her skull, and she'll begin to think like you and see things like you see things and have a perspective like you. Touch her in the name of Jesus. God, we pray, God, that even the sickness in her body, we pray that it be touched and healed in Jesus' name. Oh God, whatever the sickness and ailment is, you said, God, that by your stripes we were already healed. And so, God, we believe your word. We trust your word. We stand on your word. Your word is true. Your word is forever settled in heaven. God, right now, even her family, in their absence today, I pray, God, that you touch that husband. You give him direction from you. You begin to lead him, God, that he can lead his family in the admonition of the Lord. I pray for those children, God, that they will begin to be raised and led in the admonition of the Lord. I pray, God, that when they get older, God, the system will not have them. Drugs and the streets will not have them. The jail will not. I blood block it in Jesus' name. Oh, I cover them in your blood. And God, I plead the blood over that house. I pray, God, you said in your word, wherever the blood was, death would have to pass over. And so, God, the death of the mind, the death of the spirit, the death of the heart, the death of emotions that makes young men, glory to God, makes them become resistant to the world, I plead the blood. Do something in this family that nobody but you can do. We'll forever praise you. We'll forever give you glory. In Jesus' name. Somebody clap those hands and shout amen. Somebody give God praise for his soul. Give him praise for what he's doing. Hallelujah. Somebody ate from the crumbs. Somebody ate from the crumbs that fell from the master's table. We're getting ready to go. But Deacon Hurst, young man beside Deacon Nurse, what God is getting ready to do for you, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of man what God is getting ready to do. The path you're on, he's going to pick you up out of it and put you on a path called straight. And even the people you've been wondering, I got to get away from these people. These people don't mean me any good. God said, you're not going to have to separate yourself by yourself. God said, I'm going to do the separating. I'm going to put you where you need to be. I'm going to acquaint you with people that only I. God says, I know what you mean. God said, it's not by coincidence that you came to church today. You've been trying to get here, but it seemed like this came up and that came up. And then sometimes emotionally and in yourself, you said, no, I can't do the church thing. I can't go there. But God said, you came today and the crumbs have fell in your lap. And all you got to do is eat of the crumbs and watch what God is going to do. Just pray, Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your might. We thank you for your strength. God, we thank you because you sent us a word. And the word you sent us was just to eat of the crumbs. And so, Father, today, as we eat these crumbs, make us whole. Make us new. Put us on a path called straight. Destroy the compromise. Destroy the compromise. Give us what we need. Give us what we need. Give us what we need. We need it. And we ask you to give it to us. In Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask Mr. Allen to come now and give our last prayer and our benediction.
We bless the name of the Lord Jesus. We pray for every spirit that is abiding in this place. But as we prepare to for the young people to go to schools, we want to ask that every heart and mind come together, that they may be covered under the blood of Jesus. Because as Reverend Langley said, the devil is running rampant. And he's getting in our children, getting in our schools, and getting in our communities. But I believe that if our minds come together and our hearts are today, that God will do what he said. And even for the children upstairs, we're going to ask the Springfields that they render their hearts and their prayers to intercede for those children upstairs. And for all of you that are in here, that have something going on within your families, within your homes, we're going to ask even on today that whatever it is we came here with, that we lay it down at the table. Because even as Jesus said, the children, suffer not the little children to come unto me. And he said, unless you come as the little children, humbling ourselves and submitting, and we can't see the kingdom of God. So we ask that our hearts today come and bow down as little children before God. Father, God, now in the name of Jesus, we thank you, O God, for your word on today. And let, Father God, that your word, Father God, not fall on deaf ears. But Father God, we're under the table, O God, needing the crumbs, O God. Whatever, Father God, it is that we need in our lives, oh God. Father God, bring us together in unity and love and endeavor to keep one spirit in this house, oh God. Father God, we ask that your Holy Ghost Spirit and your Holy Ghost power abide in this place, oh God, now and forever, oh God. We ask that you continue to touch the man of God, that he may surrender and submit himself unto you, God. Uncompromising in your word, oh God. Fill him, oh God, in the name of Jesus. As he prepare, oh God, to do the eulogy, oh God, of his grandfather. Give him strength where he needs, oh God. Father God, like only you can, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we believe you in all things. We trust you on today. That you touch our children, oh God. That, Father God, that you will bring them back unto you, oh God. Even those, Father God, who have been out of the ark of safety, oh God. We ask it on today, oh God, that they come back to you, oh God. Knowing in the name of Jesus that, Father God, where they have erred, oh God, that you have not forsaken them. Oh, Father God, we thank you and we praise and bless your holy name. Father God, everyone in this place, let our hearts and mind come together that we may continue to lift up the name of Jesus and continue to lift up one another and to be encouraged. Even at our state where we at now, be encouraged, be encouraged, be encouraged. And Father God, for the young soul who came today, we thank you. And we pray, oh God, that heaven, Father God, is pleased. And we rejoice with you on today. Now, God, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you go with each one of us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And now if all hearts and minds are clear, we ask that you lift your hands in benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide henceforth, now and forever. And we all say, Amen.